I'm going to open it up now to the audience for brief questions and comments. And I want to give first an opportunity to Ambassador Koch, if you would like to respond and give your own assessment about where South Sudan needs to go. One logistical detail, make sure when you speak that your microphone's on. I think there's a button there. And then when you're done, turn it off so that we don't mix up the audio here. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe. And I would like to thank the African Center for Strategic Studies for organizing this wonderful discussion about the future of South Sudan. I have a few comments to make. One on the causes of the conflict. And a number of causes have been put forward. I don't disagree with all, but I disagree with one, that political space was limited to some of the leaders in the SPLM. I think all the actors following the conclusion of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement have had very high space, political space allotted to them. The government of Southern Sudan then included all the political parties in its governance in South Sudan. Many of the actors today who feel they have been excluded or their political space has been very much reduced were very much in charge of running the show, implementation of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, organization of the elections and of the referendum, overseeing economic development. So by and large, I would tend to think that it is not fair to assume that space was reduced for those who are in opposition today. Yes, unfortunately, the result of the violence has led to a lot of costs in lives and materials for the people of South Sudan. And it is unfortunate. We are determined to find an end to it. And this is what has come through the conclusion of the ceasefire. We think the way forward now is an inclusive dialogue. And that inclusive dialogue did not begin after the violence. South Sudanese authorities have been in dialogue with other opposition groups. Many of you may recall that SPLM DC, SPLM for Democratic Change, was in opposition for a very long time after the former Minister of Foreign Affairs, Dr. Lamakol, contested against the president. And once he lost, he decided to get into exile and not come even for the Declaration of Independence. But we were able recently to find a solution and agree. So this was creating political space for everybody. The government of South Sudan today has the third authority, the Minister for Cabinet Affairs, from a very small political party, South Sudan Democratic Forum, and many other political forces in the country, even without representation in the parliament, are represented in government. I think this is what I would call political space. Recently, the church leaders led a reconciliation process with one of the strongest fighters, David Yao Yao, and they have reached an agreement. So the desire for inclusion and our determination to reach out has been very well expressed. We want to continue with that through the upcoming dialogue in Addis Ababa by inviting political leaders, including David Yao Yao and Dr. Lamar Kol and other political parties, by inviting religious leaders, women's groups, youth, and all the stakeholders to participate. This has been clearly stated a number of times. So that is one way forward. We hope through such a mechanism that would be creating conditions of confidence building and cooperation amongst the South Sudanese people to have stability and readiness for the next phase of elections. We hope and think that the only method to create open space and democratic processes be given a content is through elections. Whether we need to wait for making a census so as to determine the populations and divide constituencies based on such population, to us is immaterial for now. Because if we do that, we are going to delay the elections, and some of the people who are competing for the top positions would feel that it is a deliberate method. So it is going to be a double-edged sword. We would not want to delay the elections. We'd want to go ahead under the same conditions we have today, and hopefully when things change for the better in the near future, we hope we can now review whatever will be that assembly and maybe hold a census, send away the assembly and hold fresh elections. Yes, the SPLA, I agree with most of the analysis that the SPLA is not fit today as a national institution. It doesn't represent all the members of our society. But it was not built on bad faith. It was built correctly to push us forward and get to stability, have elections, have the referendum without interruption. It has backfired. So there is a review. Many people are cognizant about the need now to, whether they are leaders or they are civil society members. There is need to review the composition of the SPLM in parity, I mean to be representative of our national composition. But we are grateful for what they do. We have to thank them and our friends who have come from the region, who did not come on their own. We have been cooperating for a very long time with them in the fight against the LRA, and it is a sovereign decision of South Sudan. It's not going to complicate anybody or anything to have friends invited and mandated by the IGAD, by the African Union, by the IGAD in particular, to be in South Sudan. So the requests for them to leave from other institutions might not be the best way. I think it would be better to cooperate with South Sudan by having a direct talk with authorities. And should the need for their presence have come to an end, then definitely South Sudan will reconsider. Yes, there is need for accountability as part of whatever is going to be agreed. We need to have to include accountability. By accountability, I'm not being particular about one group. Whoever has committed a crime against an individual, against a community, must be taken to justice. I know there are seven officers who have been identified to have used excessive power against some civilians, and they are under investigation, and the results will be publicized very soon. The constitutional review is an absolute necessity. It has been underway, sometimes blocked by the internal quibbles, but it is a necessary way forward. And there are so many ways of making a permanent constitution. But the current review process should be carried forward to the end. Power sharing in the during the transitional period is a possibility. It depends how we'll work it out. We have always been accommodative of ourselves. This is not the first time we are quarreling, but in our house we quarrel, but again we sit down to talk, to eat together, and to laugh. And so I believe that the current violence is going to create an opportunity for us to rethink our relations, our policies, our vision for South Sudan, and finding our space within the international community, but not as a protectorate. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ambassador Kutchin. Thank you for being here again, and thank you for your candor in responding to these observations and comments, and your observation about the SPLA and need for reform and greater inclusiveness. You highlight many of the same themes that were brought out here on the panel about the need for political space and inclusiveness, and political inclusiveness, and some of the efforts made by the government to involve other parties. you talk about the need for more accountability and mechanisms for power sharing, and realizing that where you're at now isn't enough for where you hope to go. So We appreciate that. I think that is very much consistent with what we were hoping to do with this discussion today and lay out some of these issues. What are the priorities? And you've given us some of what you see as the priorities. And now what do we need to do to make these a reality moving forward here in the interim, medium term trajectory? So now we'll open it up to the general audience. And just in terms of timing, since we've gone a little bit late, we're going to take this to 11:15 and give folks a chance to get a few more questions in and facilitate more of that exchange. So we're going to start way back in the corner over here. Please speak into a microphone, identify yourself, and keep your comment or question brief. We'll take three questions.
Thank you very much. My name is Res Moitang, member of the National Legislative Assembly in the Republic of South Sudan. They call me the last born of the parliament because I'm the youngest. I'm so much pleased to be here. I just came from Addis before 3 days. And I'm also part of the negotiation feast that is taking place in Addis. Also one of the survivors who came from Juba, almost killed, escaped the death for 20 minutes. My house was destroyed by the militia, and my brother was killed and his wife. But after all, I'm not bitter because I'm a leader of this nation. I will be ready to forgive and forget whatever happened, and I will be ready also to contribute to the building of the nation of this country. I will be very specific, and I will go directly to the point. First of all, I will talk about the root cause of the problem. Number one, South Sudan have a big problem. We have not died as a tribe and merged as one nation. We're still a tribe. Our leader did not do much, including myself, to fight this disease of tribalism. And our government system, employment in the public services, is done on tribal basis. You find one institution being dominated by one tribe from the gatekeeper up to the minister. And sometimes you find people speaking in their own language. If you come to the institution, you will get very hard to get into the system because people are using their own language instead of national language. So tribalism is one thing that is killing our people today. We have also a weak system of the governance where there is no accountability and there is no transparency. And in the parliament, we have a lot of difficulties. And one thing that almost led me to be killed is because of the way that I talk in the parliament. I used to be vocal about corruption and also contribute a lot rejecting some of the appointed members by the president because we thought they are not fit for the position. And even our diplomatic mission, we have 80 ambassadors out from one tribe. Our army is set up in the tribe on a tribal basis. If you go to the army, all the tank drivers, they are from one tribe. Artillery, those who are going for training in outside world, they are from one tribe. These are the root cause of the problem. And we will not be shy to tell the truth because we know that when we tell the truth is when we will come out with a real solution to the problem. When the fighting started, I was in Juba on the 15th. It started because nobody was knowing that it's going to happen because it was not a coup, actually. It was something fabricated, maybe for the president to kill the opponent or maybe arrest them and go to election without them. Maybe later on after they win the election, he will give them amnesty and then they will be not active in the politics. This is what we understood. I had to be in my house for...
Sir, if you could then wrap up your point. You've okay. Made the point about tribalism.
All right, and then and we have also a weak system of judicial system is very weak. It's also based on tribalism. And the abuse of the power by the president because he could remove the elected governor and remove some of the MP because they told him that you are not right and all this. And the way forward is that we are now not a country. We don't have an army. That's why we see Museveni is intervening. There is no army, and there is no government system. The only way is we have to make interim period, write a constitution, go for election. And in that interim period, we should get a neutral person, even a pastor, can lead that one for 1 year or 2 years, and then later on we go for election. I think that will be the only way. Because if we keep putting people together with that mess, because now about 17,000 people died in Juba. And this mostly from one tribe. Because of the militiamen, 15,000 who were trained by the president at the pretext of presidential guard. When they came, they go door to door looking for people. So these are the things we will forgive, and we will love to tell the international community that the only way is for our president to step aside. Another person come in, whoever he is, provided that he's a South Sudanese, we go for an interim period, 2 years, 3 years, write a constitution that did not give power, too much power to the president, we go for election, and thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate your personal sharing, and I appreciate you moving us forward, thinking about what has to happen here in this medium-term future. To the extent possible, I'd like to avoid focusing on what's happened in the past now and really use the time we have to look about where things need to go and focus on some of the priorities. Are there a lot of hands? So we'll go here and then.
Hi, I'm Ellen Ratten, project in Northern by the Ghazal. The following, how do you get aid to the people? If you go to the markets, USAID's materials, European Union's are all for sale. They're not getting to the people. How do you get the aid to the people right now?
Okay, thank you very much for the clarity. Go ahead.
I'm interested in the panelists' thoughts on the role.
Can you remind us who you are?
Sorry, yes, Lauren Plock Blanchard with the Congressional Research Service. Interested in the panelists' thoughts on the role of IGAD in the mediation going forward. Ambassador Booth, you mentioned how critical they've been to the process so far, and obviously, in terms of timeliness and pressure, they were very instrumental. But going forward, and in terms of focusing on an inclusive political dialogue, the role that they played in the CPA talks that was an exclusive rather than inclusive process. I guess, you know, there's some questions about the role of Uganda and its military operations in South Sudan right now on behalf of the South Sudan government. Kiir is obviously a sitting head of state and head of state of the IGAD administration. Ethiopia, Uganda, these are one-party states. So in the interest of sort of expanding the dialogue beyond the SPLM, are they necessarily the most appropriate body to lead the effort going forward?
Okay, thank you. And if you could remember to turn off your microphone when you're done, we won't pick up the background noise. We'll take one more question. Ambassador Bellamy, please.
Hi, I'm Mark Bellamy, a former director of the Africa Center. My question is sort of parallels Lauren's, and this is really a question for any or all of the panelists. How great is the risk, in your view, that if we go through a protracted process of trying to implement a ceasefire and separate the parties and so forth, that the mediators, the region, and the international community will decide that's as far as we can go. You know, there is this very necessary state-building agenda out there if South Sudan is to get off this trajectory towards state failure, but really as far as we can go is to get back to the status quo ante. And is that a risk? And if so, what do we need to do to mitigate it?
Okay, thank you. So we've got a number of questions, varying issues on the table. I'll give the panel a chance to respond, pick up which dimensions of this you'd like to, and if you don't have anything to add, then that's fine. We'll just go to another round. So Ambassador Booth, would you like to lead us off?
Okay, let me start just briefly, and I think maybe Kate, with her experience, can answer more directly the question of how do you get aid to the people. But one of the key things is getting aid to those who are the most vulnerable, who tend to be, at this point, are those that are internally displaced. And many of them are in UNMISS camps at this point. And so the World Food Program is taking the lead on trying to move food and non-food items to support them. But that's just one component of it. To answer the question about IGAD mediation going forward, I read a quote out of the IGAD communique. And what it made very clear in the instructions to the mediators was that they need to engage in a comprehensive, inclusive process. So while, yes, many IGAD members have dominant party systems, that doesn't mean that that's what they're trying to impose on South Sudan. They recognize that South Sudan needs to have, in order to achieve stability, has to have a broader base consultation. So the first approach on this is really for the mediators themselves to collect ideas and input from a broad base of South Sudanese society in order to try to develop a framework to propose to the South Sudanese themselves for moving forward on the political dialogue to address the underlying causes of this conflict. Mark, in terms of are we going to stop at the cessation of hostilities, absolutely not. While work is going on to try to get the monitoring and verification mechanism up and running and working effectively, and IGAD member states and the international community will need to back up the reporting of that mechanism in order to put pressure on the parties to comply with the COH. There's already the process. In fact, there'll be a meeting that's been called for the 10th of February in Addis to try to bring the parties back together to start talking about this framework for the inclusive political talks that will address at least the governance party structures going forward. And there are many other ideas that are out there as well that may be pursued, from reconciliation to security sector reform to economic issues. So clearly there is a broad, I think, international backing for the IGAD mediation to continue to pursue this effort, and IGAD heads of state have indicated their commitment to sticking with this.
Okay. On the access to humanitarian aid, the logistical challenges aside, or the negotiations of access aside, I think what is happening already, the way that the aid agencies are responding, and the narrative of how the country got here, are all, well, too reminiscent of the period between 1991 and 2005, when OLS was, Operation Lifeline Sudan was active. And I think it relates to the ambassador's question as well, that perhaps the negotiation of aid and access to aid, we must be very, very watchful of it, so that it does not become another war front between the parties, so that it doesn't become so intrinsically linked to conflict, because that is how you get the conflict to be protracted, when aid itself becomes linked to conflict. Already we see that different the government and the opposition might entrench themselves in their own position, where they will want independent access to aid, and it will once again let South Sudanese leaders off the hook from their responsibility for welfare of their people, because the international community will be feeding their people, so they can just go on fighting their own war. I think we have to be extremely careful about how aid can be played into the conflict. And if OLS is what we are looking at all over again, tragically, I think we are looking at a very protracted situation in South Sudan.
I would just echo Jacques' comments. I can't speak for current U.S. government assistance, certainly, and I haven't been in South Sudan since the crisis broke out to see firsthand. But I have to say, I find watching from a distance here in the United States, the discussion on delivery of humanitarian assistance and the problems, never mind the logistical challenges, but the problems with the parties, with the government and the opposition, in terms of interference and theft of humanitarian commodities is deeply disturbing. And I, too, feel that going back to the Operation Lifeline Sudan type scenario, which was an overall negotiated access mechanism where each side got to turn on and off access to the area that they controlled and to determine when and how vulnerable populations could be reached, would be disastrous. I think if I were sitting in a seat at USAID or another donor, we would be having a very difficult, tough conversation about how that was going to play out and what the role of the government is. This is a very different situation than it was before. The government is responsible for its people. And the fact that we have over 3.5, 3.7 million in need of emergency food assistance just between now and the next rainy season, when that map that you can see posted here and to the side, a vast amount of the countryside will be inaccessible. You will not be able to reach populations with any kind of assistance, to be stolen or distributed or otherwise. And so time is of the essence. I hear over and over again that the SPLA is a professional army. Many quotes coming out from the government, from Juba and from key ministers there. If it were a professional army, there would not be theft of humanitarian commodities, period. So it's a very serious question, and it's one that has to be addressed front on, because it cannot feed a logic of we can just not, never mind going back to the status quo ante of December 14th, we're going all the way back to well before the peace agreement was even conceived of as a process in terms of negotiations and back to the 90s in terms of how humanitarian aid operated in South Sudan. So I think it's very, very disturbing. It's a very troubling situation. It's one that we should be able to work with the government as partners in getting through the interim period and the referendum and independence thus far. We shouldn't be in this kind of situation and dialogue over delivery of humanitarian assistance for certain. I would also just maybe offer a comment to Lauren's question about the IGAD mediation going forward and an inclusive process. And I think that it's vital from the outset that the talks, the next phase of talks, be set up, not just as the two opposing sides and the handful of delegates representing them in Addis, and then representatives sort of perched around them observing and trying to sway positions on the margins of the talks in Addis, but there be direct linkages and consultations for starters in South Sudan that inform how the mediators frame the talk and how they set up the process going forward. I think most critically, the government of South Sudan must accept that there needs to be a political transition and that it has to be broader than the government and determining how to reconcile within the SPLM and with those in opposition currently. Certainly the detainees that are under much discussion and attention are part of that dialogue, but by no means sufficient for an inclusive process going forward. And it really needs to be set up fundamentally different than the CPA negotiations, which took place to get us to this point.
Yeah, just, I think that the two imperatives, ending the violence and delivering humanitarian assistance, have really have or threatened to shape the playing field. A lot of thought has gone in how to transition from cessation of hostilities into political talks about inclusivity and creating mechanisms to monitor on ground by the community this cessation of hostilities. I think the same kind of thinking needs to go into the aid effort, getting the aid to the people and the people to the aid. Recognizing, as Kate and Jacques both pointed out, OLS, the longest emergency airlift operation in the history of the United Nations is not really the model you're going for to avoid the risk that you've said of creating a permanent unstable environment. I think we need to look at both of those to avoid this risk that what we're going to do is an entrench, create a polarized South Sudan, and entrench it further. I think just the simple question, as I pointed out before in my presentation, of asking, of setting up the aid architecture, who gives you permission to go, who's your counterpart
that guarantees this security? Who gives you, who's going to help you distribute that food all the way down and hand it to the village, is in itself establishing a political system. It is itself establishing an aid patronage network that is very hard to break. And if we recognize that the conflict is can be ultimately unwinnable if it becomes asymmetric, i.e. one side, the opposition side making areas ungovernable as opposed to governing them, then this thing will go and this aid will perpetuate that in the absence of any real political solution or transition. Thank you.
Okay, let's take another round of questions and comments. Go here first. I know. Yes, you, sir.
Richard Loban from the Naval War College and Sudan Studies Association. And I really appreciate the optimistic view that has been presented, the path to stability, as is the title. But I think you're struggling to get the glass half full, when in fact it really is at least more than half empty. And it seems like the main agenda should be management of crisis and conflict. I'm inclined to look at that when I see the map that says Unity State next to Abyei, and it's the most contested, least unified place. When I look at the call for release of detainees, and yet simultaneously the call for accountability, and those aren't easily reconciled. And I think that the discussion would be enhanced today when we would talk about David Yao Yao, George Athor, the new railway maybe between Baba Nusa and Wao, the question of the whole neighborhood being in a pretty horrible condition. When a special envoy Scott Grattan and I were training the first cohort to go to Juba, everyone was very optimistic, much like the panelists, a pathway forward, let's go ahead. And yet I said, just slow down a little bit. You have to look at what's going to be the situation in South Sudan after independence. All the people are going to be the same people. The neighbors will be the same neighborhood. North Sudan is not going to move to the North Pole and South Sudan move to some other place. It's going to still have neighbors with CAR, which is a complete and total wreck today. Uganda is not exactly a model for democracy, not to mention human rights. Kenya's, when the last time I was in Juba, Kenya was having its election, which didn't turn out exactly perfectly. And Khartoum is still in a complete wreck. And that's the situation. So my comment is perhaps we need to recalibrate instead of pathway to stability and some halcyon future, but we need to make an agenda which is far more realistic management of crisis and conflict, because that's what's going to be on the agenda. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Please, right here.
My name is Leslie Warner. I'm a political military analyst focusing on Africa at CNA. And my question is with regard to the UPDF deployment to South Sudan. Of course, it came at the invitation of the government of South Sudan, which as a sovereign nation is their prerogative. But I'm particularly interested from a U.S. government standpoint. Does the U.S. see a conflict of interest between Uganda acting as a IGAD mediator and their concurrent role as a partisan combatant within the current conflict? And from across the panel, I'd be interested in perspectives on whether there should be pressure to try and get the PDF to restrict their mission in South Sudan to focusing on civilian protection, which I, from a personal standpoint, I think that could be a useful use of UPDF efforts in South Sudan. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. The gentleman in the blue sweater there.
Thank you. My name is Henry Legue from the Center for International Private Enterprise, one of the core institutes of the National Endowment for Democracy. It's a three-part question. Where now exist specific opportunities for the citizens' private sector as opposed to the large government private sector or government-owned economy? What are the opportunities for the citizens' private sector in the transition process? What changes need to occur so that the voice of the citizens' private sector is both representative and strong? And then, somewhat building off the last two questions, timing. Can the private sector dimension be included now, or are there reasons for it to be held off?
Okay, thank you. Very relevant to some of the comments made by a panelist. And then finally, final question this round on the backside of the front row here.
Thank you so much. My name is Movian Lut, and I work for the Enough Project doing research on South Sudan. My question actually would focus on the reconciliation and justice process that is now one of the topics that is being discussed here. And my question would go directly to Ambassador Donald Booth. I want to know, like, to what extent is actually the U.S. government engaged in the process of reconciliation and justice, and how are they working to make sure that this process is going to be inclusive of all stakeholders in South Sudan? Thank you.
Okay, and let me turn it over to the panel. And do so, let me slip in a question that I have. Several of the panelists emphasized the division between elites and ordinary citizens as being a key tension and an ongoing problem. I'd invite any of the panelists to talk about how does that get resolved here in the short term. You know, how do you start to work towards that resolving that issue? Let's go in the same order. Ambassador Booth, please.
Let me take the last question first. The U.S. Had been supporting numerous community peace building and conflict resolution activities through implementing partners in South Sudan. A lot of the conflicts that occurred in places like the Wandlet Triangle and Jonglei, along the border areas where there are migrations and annually, these were areas where we had activities to try to keep the communities talking to each other and at peace. We were also supportive of the National Peace and Reconciliation Commission's efforts that led by the Archbishop. So we were involved in prior to this conflict in trying to help South Sudanese address issues of reconciliation and conflict avoidance. In terms of the role of private enterprise, I think the private sector was one of the many groups that we've indicated that we believe and have talked to IGAD mediators about believing that they should consult to get input into, again, how do you structure a comprehensive approach to this conflict, to the resolution of this conflict? What are the issues that need to be addressed? I mean, I think one of the key things that should be of key interest to the private sector, and I would hope that the South Sudanese private sector would raise this, would be the question of transparency. You've had a system where the economy has not been a paragon of transparency, and I think that tends to constrict what the private sector is then able to do. In terms of the role of the UPDF deployment, they were invited in by the government of South Sudan. They initially went in to protect critical infrastructure in the area of Juba and the Juba-Nimule Road. They helped facilitate by protecting that infrastructure, the departure of foreign nationals, particularly Ugandan nationals. And they then took an additional role and actually did begin to participate in the conflict, fighting alongside the SPLA. The cessation of hostilities agreement is very clear that with the signing of that agreement, there should be a progressive withdrawal of all foreign forces. And that point has been made very explicitly to Uganda by myself and others. It has been discussed and reinforced in the IGAD summit that was held on the 31st. The role that they're playing now is one of trying to maintain a modicum of stability, particularly in the area around Juba. But it's also important that their forces do begin a progressive withdrawal from the country. In terms of the release of detainees not being compatible with accountability, I'm not quite sure I get that point. The detainees were arrested at the very beginning of this conflict, could not have been participants in any of the atrocities that occurred while they were in detention. So I'm not quite sure about that point. If you're talking about accountability for perhaps past corruption, that's certainly an issue that would need to be addressed. But that's, I think, something down the road. The role of the detainees as senior members of the SPLM can play is to bring a diversity of voices into the discussion of how the SPLM is going to reform itself and also how the broader governance discussions will go forward. You raised a litany of the regional woes, and yes, it is a terribly troubled region. There are many, many crises active, if not brewing below the surface in the region. But I think it's very important that the regional organization, IGAD, has really come together and trying to address, in particular, this crisis. And it has put a lot of its differences aside to do that. And Uganda is not actually part of the mediation, so they are a member of IGAD, but they do not have a mediator there. It's Ethiopia, Kenya, and Sudan who have provided the three mediators to actually work with the South Sudanese parties. And Uganda has very, I think, purposely stayed away from the mediation, from the talks itself.
Yeah, I agree with Richard about this, as Ambassador said, about all these problems in the region. But the source of optimism is the past of South Sudan. People have disagreed, people have fought, but they have always found ways to at least patch them up if they cannot resolve them entirely. I think it is that patching up or sweeping of these problems under the rug that we don't want to continue, that these problems are brought forward and discussed with honesty with an eye to having a more conciliatory future. The issue of political detainees, of course, is a complex one. On the one hand, if you are charging them now with corruption, you can find another 11 people within the government that you can charge for corruption. So the issue of accountability does not really connect with the request to release them. If you cannot charge them, you have to release them, because that's what our law says. That's the laws of South Sudan and international law. You can't hold people indefinitely without charge. That should be the main focus, rather than the question of whether they were involved in a coup or not. The pressure should be based on the illegality of their detention without charge. And that would actually get the government cooperating more than the denial of a coup. On the issue of the private sector, referring back to what Jason was describing as the economy of the government and the economy of the people, I think there is a place where they meet. Because the private sector does not have a long history of access to capital in South Sudan. So it's still going to be the same government economy that is going to feed into private sector. The only problem is that how are you going to feed that? How are you going to get the private sector to have access to government economy? The way to do it is to think very carefully about how you use the revenue from natural resources, particularly oil. So far, oil revenue has been used for a current cost for running government. And that means the economy will remain entirely a government economy. And so the best way to go forward, I think, would be to find ways to invest majority of that oil money in capital projects, in agriculture, in electricity generation, in road building, which will employ up to 1.5 to 2 million South Sudanese, as opposed to the oil industry, which employs only 8 to 10,000 people. So if you stop using the oil money for recurrent cost and invest it in projects, that will then employ a lot of people, and those people will be taxpayers, and the tax money will be now used to run the government, then that is how you feed this private sector into it, because all these projects will be contracted to local businesses. And I think it will also solve the dilemma Jason was talking about. How can you prevent, how can you take away money from all these civil servants?
you will not be taking the money away. It will be another way of redistributing the money to a larger population than just the 700,000 officials that are employed. You will be redistributing the oil money through employment of a larger number of people in the projects. Thank you.
Thanks. I guess I would just like to offer that I don't think that having hope is a naive thing for South Sudan. I think that it's, in fact, vitally important to be able to see a vision for a way out and to recognize the lessons that the world has to offer and how cycles of violence can come to an end and what have been key common factors in those situations. So I hope that's what we've been able to do here today, recognizing that South Sudan is, in fact, still in a very serious state of crisis, that the fighting has not stopped yet, but it is not doomed to stay here. And in fact, there is every reason to believe that it can end this current conflict, it can end the division, that it can move to a more open and inclusive society and polity. I think it's imperative for us to focus on the conditions that will be conducive to that reality. I think one of those is foreclosing the military option that both sides must still feel is on the table, since the ceasefire, the cessation of hostilities, has not stopped the fighting. And every day there are reports of more military activity coming from various parts of South Sudan. I think in that regard, having the UPDF deployed in the country is deeply unhelpful to the situation. If the government needs assistance with security of key infrastructure and other assets, then surely there are more neutral sources for that assistance to be found from, and ones that don't have the same conflicts of interest and polarizing effect that the Ugandan military does among the South Sudan population. So I do believe that, in fact, having the UPDF withdraw would help to spur the conditions for peace and for stability. I think that ensuring that arms flows are stopped to South Sudan, to all sides, is another way of ensuring that the military option doesn't persist and that we can move on to the political dialogue that needs to take place. I think that in that regard, Joe, your question on how do we address the divide between the elites and the rest of the country, clearly we've all emphasized civil society and non-state voices and institutions. At some level, it will be up to the elites determine if they're going to invite and genuinely welcome those voices and that participation, or if it's going to be a harder struggle, a more challenging one, even perhaps one of personal peril for those voices to be raised and to be heard. We hope that it will be a collaborative process going forward, that this will be a wake-up call for all parts of South Sudan, not just those in government, but other political leadership, community leadership, for everyone to recognize that there must be some changes here in terms of how the deep underlying issues that Jacques pointed out are confronted and addressed so that the country can move forward.
Thank you. Just to say that we have focused on stability again and again and again, and that's actually the story of the interim period, the failure of elections, the failure of any democratic change in military that wasn't there. Sorry. I don't think the issue is prioritizing stability and the wishful hope of a new future. I think that the critical point here is we've neglected the transformation. We focused on stability and neglected the transformation or the transformative aspects, especially during the CPA. Things that change it, land, the professional army, building a government, making a multi-party system, they were put aside when it came to stability again and again. So I think that's kind of a recognition that what you have to look at is something different. How do you change so it doesn't come back? And again, back to this point that the transition is not a 20-year plan. It's really focusing on those conditions in which these events can be genuinely transformative. And that, in many ways, is about stability, freedom to speak, freedom to associate, able to talk, that kind of stability that allows people to engage inclusively, safely, as communities between each other and as political rivals in a political system that is not militarized. On the good question on the economy, I think just adding to what Jacques said, in terms of investing the revenue into back into the development of the state, I think also understanding the land law, the discussion around land, which should ideally secure and recognize customary rights in land, not just those held by individuals, but those held by communities. And therefore, if that structure is there and enforced, then the partnership is not between the private investor from outside and the state over that resource, giving them rights and access in that resource. It's between the communities and the investor, and the state is an enabler and benefits from taxes. So looking at the land regime in a way that promotes people-private partnerships, not state-public private partnerships, is a way to go. I'd also say just that there's a kind of a regional importance to South Sudan that hasn't been discussed, but it's an interesting conversation, looking at the Sud or the swamp, the floodplains, because they provide, importantly in the region, climate stability, carbon sink, biodiversity, that this is a massive resource that needs to be protected, developed responsibly, and is at risk of paying for the peace or the recovery or the development or the war if it continues. And so if there's an interest in the region of protecting this very important resource so it doesn't get sold, developed, farmed, it needs to be what the regional, it needs to be responsibility internationally to say, let's hold this, because it's not a great place where you want climate instability given the amount we spend on famines and food aid and things like that. Easy, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much to all the panelists. I'm afraid we've come to the end of our time here. I know there are a lot of other questions still out there. I'm sorry I wasn't able to get to everybody. But before we break, I do want to just thank my ACSS colleagues for all the work that went into hosting this event today. I appreciate all of your work. And I would like to, again, thank our panelists. First of all, for taking the time out of some very busy schedules, and for giving us your thoughtful assessments about where things need to go and what the priorities might be. It isn't easy. This is a very fluid time period, and there are so many different things going on. And none of you sugarcoated what was happening. But at the same time, you've helped us in what will be an ongoing conversation about where we need to get to if we're going to achieve stability, which is a longer term undertaking. And so I just ask you all to join me in thanking our panelists for really what was a wonderful session today.